Send the whips in first.
That's right. Well, the guys that really count, move this thing along.
I saw you on Saturday Newsmaker, whatever it was. You did a good job. You didn't give one straight answer.
Dr. Jesse.
So since I've been in this job, because things come to my attention about people who have little hobbies or something that just show an amazing ability at doing something. After the show Saturday night out here in South Lawn, one of the guests, a man there, handed me something that out of his pocket, handed Nancy, then handed Marlon Havendish one, and in each case it was our initials. There are my initials. That is a dollar bill. I can't in any way figure out how that folded and then went, no cutting.
No cutting.
Yes.
And Nancy's,
No. But then Nancy's was N-R, and Marvin's was his initials. But there they are. And that's a dollar bill.
That's nice.
You look at that intricate fold.
I wish Newsting could do something like that.
I know.
I got one more time made in the form of an elephant.
Oh.
I wonder if the same doggone guy got it someplace stashed away.
Well, I was saying, I've got out at the ranch, I've got a very handsome seal, a great seal. It's on wood with what looks like a dull kind of silver or pewter inside, all the things, including every star and everything, until you look closely at it. The wood is there, but what I thought was silver or something are nails. So close together that there it is, just perfect. Every little star and everything. And every one of individual nails just packed together so thick that you know he must have had to use a punch for
the time. The time that you know they invested.
Yeah.
President, the Prime Minister of IT.
Very nice. Very glad to have the opportunity.
Well, we can chair there, and we'll have a small talk for a while. There'll be three waves of press coming. Some of them try to ask questions. Sometimes they ask questions. Small talk. We're not talking about it.
Record
plus the humidity.
Mr. President, are you flattered that Governor Dukakis said yesterday that he believes he and you agree more closely on East-West relations than you and the Vice President of the United States?
I'm just more of the suspicious type.
Mr. President, if it's the only way you can get Contra aid, will you accept the Byrd proposal?
I'm supporting the Dole proposal right now.
But it doesn't look like that's going to pass.
Well.
Who's your candidate for running mate for Vice President Bush?
What?
Who is your candidate for the number two spot?
I don't have a candidate.
At all?
No, that's up to him.
You want to get your national security advisor?
You want to watch out, he's standing right behind you.
Lights, please, thank you.
Lights?
Please, we have another group to get out.
Mr. Raspberry, they call
him. The other group. Might be outside. Let's go, please, Cameron, Cal, Phil.
CNN.
John, that way, please.
Iceland right now. We appreciate it very much.
Mr. President, my name is Kaurason from the Democratic Iceland. I was wondering if there is any possibility that Iceland and the United States would make some free trade agreement in the near future, maybe similar to what you have done between USA and Canada.
Well, I think it's something certainly for us to talk about. Because I think our relationship is a really fine one with Iceland, and something of that kind could probably make it even better.
Do you personally take it? Do you personally take it?
Right up the street, please. Right up the street, please. Right up the street, please. Outside.
Every place.
Sorry.
Mr. President? What do you think about the idea of the Icelandic foreign minister about the Reykjavik Foundation as an international peace organization?
So the meeting is about to
begin.
We've had some talks to find out what you're asking for. Your visit is a first for an Icelandic prime minister, and I think you and I have discussed your visit demonstrates the strong and beneficial relationship that Iceland and the United States enjoys. I think perhaps since our last meeting had to do with summits with the East and our East-West relationship, that perhaps I should say a few words about the most recent trip, the Moscow summit. And we feel that it was a success. And perhaps most gratifying was the opportunity we had to speak directly about our Western values and traditions with the Soviet people themselves, not just with members of the Politburo. I know my encounters with Soviet citizens, young people at the Moscow University, people on the street, dissidents and refuseniks and writers and artists have helped break down, I think, some barriers of misunderstanding. As a matter of fact, we were all greatly surprised at the attitude of the people themselves, just the people on the street that you met. There was a friendship, a friendliness, and a warmth in their greeting that was very reassuring and somewhat different than sometimes we get from the members of the Politburo. But we agreed to expand exchanges and people-to-people contacts, especially among young people. In fact, the General Secretary was quite enthused when we made that proposal about taking our young people, say, at about high school age and having them spend some time in each other's country, living with the families of our people. The Soviets still have a long way to go, but we're encouraged on the progress that has been made on the human rights front. And we welcome the Afghanistan agreement, the first phase of their Soviet troop withdrawal, and we're encouraged by progress toward resolving other regional conflicts such as the Iran-Iraq affair, the Southern Africa, and now Cambodia. And so we signed the INF Treaty, as you know, or the instruments of ratification, I should say, in Moscow. We had already signed the treaty. Progress toward a START treaty, that's the one 50% reduction in the intercontinental ballistic missiles. The progress is slow. It's much more complicated than the first one was, but we'll go as far as we can during the remainder of this year. And we won't, however, we've avoided setting any deadlines. We think what we want is a good treaty and not just get something to meet a deadline for signing. So however long it takes, we'll stay at the table there with them. We're pursuing our strategic defense initiative. That was the thing that came to a head in Iceland in 86 when we met back, and was the point of difference where that was the price they wanted us to pay for just anything. But I think I should tell you that we've gone far enough in the research and development of that strategic defense plan to be very confident we are going to be able to come up with a defense. Somebody gets in their office, it tends to be a little different too. But it's he's saying those things that we're going to use against him in the campaign because I don't think that if the people really understand some of those things and what they would mean, I don't think they would be supportive of it. It's a strange thing. The other side's legislature, Congress, the Democratic Congresses have always, even when their presidents were Democrats also, they've always, for some reason, been against defense spending. It's many people don't remember that back when Franklin Delano Roosevelt was president, and when the Great War was going on in Europe and the world going up in flames, and we had to recognize that, well, as did happen, that finally we were involved in it. We, just a few weeks before Pearl Harbor, we had our military then was conscription. Now it's volunteer, but conscription. And the Congress only failed by one vote of wiping out the military draft. Or when Pearl Harbor came, if they'd had their way, there wouldn't have been much of a military.
There are two. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
There are two fallacies. Marlon, ready?
Mr. President.
Hello.
My name is Delano Lewis, President of the Greater Washington Board of Trade.
Well, let's get a.
Thank you, sir.
Nice to see you.
Oh, my pleasure.
Mr. President, Art Howard, Washington Gaslight Company.
I'm John Tidings with the Board of Trade.
Well, nice to see you and have you all here.
It's a real pleasure to have the opportunity.
A picture of all of us behind the desk here.
Mr. President, a real pleasure for me as President of the Washington Board of Trade. Started in January, my terms for a year, to give you an honorary membership to the Greater Washington Board of Trade. You're one of our leading citizens, one of our largest employers, and we want you to have this as an honorary membership.
Well, thank you all very much.
My pleasure.
I appreciate it very much. And incidentally, I want to congratulate you on the job that you're doing, because here in your area, the unemployment rate is only 2.7%. And I know your efforts in promoting jobs and so forth.
Well, it's the surprise in this area that more people work in the private sector than they do in government, which is often forgotten.
As a matter of fact, I have a little hobby on every Sunday. Sunday the help wanted ads. That's when they reach their peak, and every Sunday in the Washington Post, I count the pages.
No kidding.
And believe it or not, they're
getting smaller.
Huh? No.
Getting larger.
No, they're getting larger. They're up there around 70 odd pages every week, full pages of employers looking for the work.
That's a good index.
Yeah, we're doing pretty well here.
It's the biggest challenge to find good
people. Now, I've been trying to help, you see, by seeing if we can't cut down the size of governments.
Well, thank you so much.
Well, thank you.
I know you had a very busy day today.
Well.
And thanks for seeing us and accepting our membership.
I'm very honored. Thank you.
It's a privilege. Thank you.
Thank you again, Mr. President.
Thank you all.
Thank you.